Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Yun here and again with another exciting episode of Let's Build. And in this episode, we're going to move on to the fun part of our character creation pipeline. This is going to be the texturing stage. Now, in the previous episode, I was doing the rigging, and I think I said I wanted to create another episode for the rigging stage, but unfortunately, while I was making the video, I found that the video just wasn't interesting at all. At least it's not interesting unless I went ahead and did a time-lapse video. So I decided to just completely skip the rest of the process and move straight onto the texturing stage just so that you guys can get at least a full idea of the entire work process, okay? Because the idea of these episodes is basically to give you guys an idea of what it's like to work in an industrial environment, and I want to keep them as interesting as possible. So let's move on to the texturing stage, and before I go on, I want to show you guys what I've actually done since the last episode. I've completed the rigging stages, and we are pretty much ready to do our texturing. So during the rigging stage, what we're really doing is we're applying all of those, you know, skin weights, making sure we get them right and working, you know, making them readable. Okay, so we don't want any weird deformations in the vertices and such. So we want to keep it really, really clean. But it was exactly the same principle as what I did with the feet. Okay, so there's nothing different in that regard. So you want to do some posing and then you start painting the weights and such. Now for the face, it's a little bit trickier because the face is extremely deformable and you have to rig the face based on animation principles, so to speak. So if you have a character sheet, it's always a good idea to get some facial references of the character so that you can see the range of emotions that you can, you know, that you have to aim for. Now, during the facial rigging stage, I actually used a facial rig that I created in the past. So this is a very simple facial rig with a very simple, easy to use UI. I just did some very basic facial rigging because I didn't have enough time to go ahead and you know, do all those little subtleties. That will come a little bit later, but for now, I just want to keep this really, really simple because this is only going to be used for posing purposes, okay? So you can see that some of these controls here don't actually work or affect the character's face. That's because once we pose this character, I'm going to use Mudbox, the sculpting tool, to manually deform certain areas to get me a much nicer result, okay? Just for pose, not for animation. But for now, it's not bad for what we want to use it for, okay? So let's go ahead and get started with our texturing stage. And I want to show you very quickly what the UV map looks like right now. And let me go ahead and select all the polygons on the scene. Okay, by the way, guys, if you don't know what this MEL code is, it's already in my description below. So go ahead and use that code and put it in your link. All right, let's go ahead and just take a quick look at this. So I've got the hair modules or the hair UV laid out. So none of these UVs are overlapping each other. Remember, this is not a video game that I'm making, so I'm not trying to save UV space. I'm just trying to keep everything in one single texture file or texture map. Okay, so we'll quickly show you what everything looks like. We've got all the hair, you know, hair pieces right there. We've got the face and ears right here. Got the back of the head, got the top of the mouth. So what I'm doing is really just making a mental map of how I've laid out my UV maps here. We've got the eyes, which are going to be really easy to do. This is the teeth and gums, which is the teeth and the gums up here. This entire segment is the hands, or the arms. We've got the torso, buttons, shirt on the inside. We've got the skirt or kilt down here. We've got the internal kilt down there. Belt buckle, mustache, strange enough, I've got the tail, because this is a mouse character, the feet down here, I've also got the legs. So a fairly simple layout, it's not too complicated, there's a lot of empty space, and typically for video games you don't really lay it out like this because you want to save as much texture space as possible, but for an animation, which this is what it actually is, this is completely fine. So what I'm going to do is, like, I'm going to save this out into Photoshop as a UV map. So all you really do is you select all the UVs, you go UV snapshot, and I'm going to save it as an 8K texture. I've already saved this image out, so I'm going to go straight into Photoshop and begin the texturing stage. Alright, so in Photoshop, once we have the texture here, you can see an 8K texture is absolutely massive, so we're going to We're going to get plenty of detail, so we're not going to be worried about that at all. But just remember, this is going to be very slow if you have a computer that's not powerful enough to handle a resolution this size. But I've chosen an 8K texture because that's my preference. Because if I wanted to scale it down or make the texture smaller, I can easily just, you know, just shrink it, resize the entire template. Alright, so that's the UV map right there. We're going to start our painting in Photoshop for now. Now, because we have so many materials here, we've got skin, we've got metal, we've got leather, we've got cloth and all that, we need to be really tidy with our naming conventions. So in Photoshop, I'm going to start by creating a group, and let's start by putting with, let's name it as skin, okay? So the skin will act as subsurface getting. Oh, by the way, guys, if you want a music playlist, I'm already a fan of video game music. So Gears of War 3, the soundtrack, is in the link below. Go ahead and take a look at that. I absolutely love the music for the Gears of War series. Definitely worth a purchase. So we'll go ahead and add another folder. And this one I'm going to name it as torso. Create another folder. Let's call it legs. So the skin is going to apply only to the head and hands, okay? The feet will be part of the legs. At least that's how I'm going to do the naming convention. I'm not sure yet. Maybe it might be a little bit different. We'll see how we go. Just go ahead and just create the folders just to be really quick. I'll call this belt, buckle. This will be metal, by the way. So how you sort this out is completely up to you guys. I just like to keep it really simple, just so that it makes sense for me to go back and, you know, make a few adjustments and such. All right, so those are the five. We've got skin, we've got the eyes right there, belt buckle, which is probably the only metal object in there, legs, torso, and I'm pretty sure I've covered everything. I don't think I'm missing anything in particular. No, as far as I know, that's pretty good. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. Let's start with, well, we'll start with the eyes. And the procedure for this, guys, I'm going to start with diffuse for the naming there. Actually, you don't really have to name that in that sense. So the procedure here is to begin with just flat colors. All right. You want to start with flat colors because that's, you know, that's the easiest way to get a general gist of the entire, I guess, the color scheme. So that's what we need to aim for to begin with. And the other thing is we're going to use a combination of Photoshop and Mudbox to get our textures right, because there are some things that you can only do in Mudbox that you can't do in Photoshop. That's, you know, it's just, sometimes it's much easier, sometimes it's better to get, gives you better details or better control. Well, whatever it is, it's up to you. But just remember, you know, whatever tools you want to use, you want to make sure you use them just to get the end result. I want to go back to, I think, one of my, oh, pardon me, oh dear. I think I'm missing something. Stand by, guys. All right, sorry about that. So I've brought the concept art in. This is something that a conceptual artist has drawn for me. Now remember, concept art helps you stay on track, and that even includes texturing. And this is definitely very, very useful to have. So I'm going to go ahead and just color select. And we're going to apply this to our flesh right now. So just the general color. We don't have to, you know, make it too, I guess, too clean in that sense. So let's just press F so that we can go ahead and do a marquee select around our skin. So this is our skin. Well, this is my skin texture anyway. So very, very carefully, just using the lasso tool, at least I think I call it a lasso tool. Let's put it around the hands as well, because remember the hand, actually we'll do the hands separately. Let's just ignore that. Oh, unbelievable, I can't stop that. Alright, so we'll go ahead and just carefully painting around the mouth. That's the tongue right there. We'll create a separate color for that. Right, so everything up here is all basically the head. And let's apply a color map. Great. It's a little bit bright, but that's all right. We'll get to that in just a moment. Let's go and marquee select the hands. So remember, it's always a good idea to lay out your UVs properly and make sure you just get everything looking as, you know, as close to the original as possible. Alright, so that's the flesh. We have the feet here, and I'm thinking I might do the feet as well because I don't think it makes sense to put it under the legs, especially if the legs have a different material. Let's go ahead and just select the feet, like so. I'm going to add, pardon me, add extra selections there, and I think I just remembered there's also the tail, so I might go ahead and do the tail as well. So let's go ahead, marquee select the tail. Let's just do everything. Great. That's our color so far, which is really good. I'm just thinking, did I miss anything? I've got a mustache there, but I think I can leave that as a separate folder. So let's go ahead and go mustache or mustache. So the mustache is like the others, or like the rest of the skin. It's going to be part of the subsurface scattering. That's what we're going to do. Just try not to select the tail there. And for the mustache, I might make it a little bit of a lighter color, just so that I can differentiate that inside the scene. Okay, so that's the skin so far, looking really nice. Let's go ahead and start applying the teeth and gums, which is found here. And again, I'm going to make another folder for this because I want this to be separate. I want to be able to edit this separately. These folders help you just work quicker, okay? It helps you work more efficiently. Teeth and gums, let's create a new layer. And of course, we go ahead and apply the color scheme. So for the gums, which is up here, let's go and turn this to some kind of a reddish color. Sort of dark reddish. These colors don't have to be accurate, by the way, guys, at the moment, at the stage. What we're really doing is just coding the colors so that we have a good visual list or visual laundry list of what we need to fix and in a later stage. We're going to do as much as we can in this episode. I'm going to keep this at around 1 hour. I think I did mention I wanted to make 2 hour videos, but I think 1 hour video is enough. All right, so we've got the teeth right here. Just unselect. Oops. Just carefully unselect certain areas so that we don't overlap our texture. And for the teeth, I'm going to give it a light gray. Never use complete white, okay, ever, for textures, because textures need to have some kind of definition. So you want it, if you want a white color, you want to keep it slightly gray or very, very light gray, somewhat something like that, so that you can get some details out of it inside your 3D scene. So that's the general rule you want to keep in mind. All right, so the teeth and gums are done. Let's go ahead and color code the rest of this. We have the belt buckle, and this is going to be metal. And hey, well, it's already gray, so it doesn't really matter. But I'm going to turn it into a slightly bluish silverish color. I want it to be a little bit silverish. Again, I'm not concerned about the exact color scheme. I just want to make it easy for me to read. So let's go ahead and just use a bluish color. It's not going to be the final color, but just gives you an idea. All right, so we've got the belt buckle. Now the torso, pardon me, the torso is going to be this segment right here. I think everything else, we've got the legs right there. Actually, let's start with the legs. I'm going to create a new layer on the legs. And because it's underneath everything else, I might as well just marquee select that, just square it up. And the color scheme for that is going to be somewhat of a darkish blue. I'll keep it at that color for now. All right, let's go to the torso. And this is where things can get a little bit tricky because I'm kind of losing track of what is what. So Let's start with the shirt segment. So I'm going to select that. And if memory serves me right, this top should be just the shirt. Okay, the interior of the shirt. It's exactly what we want. Okay, and for the shirt, let's go ahead and select that. It's got a beige-ish look. And select the jacket. And the jacket is going to look green. Alrighty. So I'm gonna keep it nice and green. I might give it a slightly darker tone. There we go. We'll get to the buttons in just a moment. So down here, this is going to be the belt. And the belt is going to be a fairly dark brown, but I'm going to make it light brown so that I can see it in my scene. Again, just color coding, nothing more. We'll be adding definition and textures very soon. And this down here is going to be the kilt, which is the same color scheme as the top. It's okay if you guys are struggling to keep up here, that's totally fine. I'm just trying to get this done as quickly as possible so that we can move on to the next stage of our texturing process. And this again is the belt, and we're pretty much done. So that's the color code of the entire character. You can see we've got some really, really nice, well, basic looking scheme, so to speak. So I'm going to go ahead, pardon me, I'm going to save this out with the UV lines. And the reason why I want to use the UV lines is just so that I can see what's going on. Okay, so we don't need that anymore. We'll go back into Maya. We don't need the UV texture anymore. So I've created two materials right here. We've got a diffuse and I've got a subsurface scattering. The subsurface scattering is obviously going to be used for the skin, but I'm going to start with just the normal default material right here to begin with. All right. So with the color, I'm going to go ahead and create a new node. Let's go add the file, and I'm going to use the PSD for this because the PSD is much quicker to, you know, update in Maya. So under that, we'll select the PSD file. It's going to take a while because this is a huge texture. There we go. Oh, pardon me. So that's our character so far, and right now everything is looking nice and clean. I don't think I've missed anything at this stage. Nope, pretty sure that's all good. So the lines, you can see why I wanted to see the lines, because I wanted to see what the resolution looks like. So I'm going to go to high quality rendering. Hopefully this won't crash the computer. If it does, we'll go straight back into it. There we go. Okay, so you can see we've got plenty of lines, and the lines are nice and crisp. Oh, and slowing down a little bit. Okay, so the lines are nice and crisp. Well, I'm going to go back to default rendering because it's very slow. But in terms of resolution, everything's fine. And what determines what resolution you want to use, guys, is dependent on how you want to use the model. For example, in an animation, I'm going to be rendering at almost 2K or cinema resolution, just about, not exactly that, but it's going to be really high resolution. So you want a very high resolution texture, okay? So you can imagine inside the map itself, the face here, this is 8K texture, down here is about 4K, the head is about 2000 pixels wide. So that's a lot of resolution. So this is 2K texture right here. Basically, you want a high enough resolution that it doesn't, in a way, it doesn't start pixelating when you do up close shots like this for the character, or when you look at their eyes. That's generally the rule. In higher production or higher level productions, they would have very, very high resolution textures because they're obviously rendering for cinema. So that's the general rule of thumb. For a video game, this can be even lower, especially if the character is, you know, if this is as far as you'll be able to see the character, then all you really need is probably just a simple 2K texture. Okay, so we'll go ahead and start adding some One last thing I forgot to fix was the buttons. Let's go ahead and fix the buttons up. I'm going to create a separate layer for the buttons. I don't want to change it into a group, I'll just keep it real simple. Let's use the elliptical tool. So select the buttons like so. Very, very carefully. I don't want to overlap that t-shirt there. And I might just use the same color as that. There we go. All right. So the next stage is just examining how we want to get this character working, I guess, in terms of the color scheme. So the useful tool to use is using no lights. Use no lights. And what I might do is actually get rid of some of these controls. So let's go ahead and hide them. Might delete the rest of them because I don't really need it. Let's hide that control. I'll also hide my HIK controls here. So let's get rid of these. And even my facial rig control here. So this is just something I've made myself, guys. So there is a tutorial in my channel that talks about how to create your own facial rig. So if you guys want to take a look at that, certainly go ahead and do that. Okay, and I think everything else is pretty good. We're pretty much ready to start our texturing stage. Now, the traditional way of texturing is you're using Photoshop to do all these little details, but because it's fairly complex and there are some little ornaments I want to add for my character, I'm going to have to, like I said, I'm going to use a combination of Mudbox and Photoshop. So I'll be going back and forth. In this episode, I might only stick with Photoshop and probably do the Mudbox episode in the next one. But what we want to do is start just examining how we can fix up some of these colors. So right now, the colors, they're just color-coded, nothing special. I want to change the color scheme because right now, some of it just doesn't really make sense to me. So I want this a little bit more brown. Let's go ahead and play around with the color curves just to get a better color out of this. Or you can just select it, and I'm just going to do it the easy way. Let's go ahead, select the color node and just turn it brown. Okay, like so. Same with the feet. I might just color pick the feet right there. Probably a little bit harsh. Now remember, textures will be lit inside the scene. So you want to find some kind of middle ground where the lights can bring that detail out of that texture. So you don't want it too vibrant, you want it sort of ever so slightly bleached in a sense. You know, lose some of that hue or opacity, lose some of that colorfulness. that's generally the way we got to go about this. For the tail, I'm going to have to manually select it because the tail isn't actually that dark. So let's go ahead and just change the color to somewhat of a similar color to that. Well, I'll use that for now. That's completely sufficient. So for the tail, let's go ahead and find another color. And I'm trying, once again, just trying to get a color scheme that looks, well, that works for me, for my eyes. Remember, when I'm texturing, I'm also doing a mental map of my rendered scene. How is this going to render? Is the texture or is this particular color going to work for this? So that's kind of what we're trying to do. So that's why concept art is so incredibly useful here, because you can make those distinctions before you do the texturing map. And I'm just trying to find a middle ground somewhere there. I think that's nice. That's kind of working for me. For the hands, we're going to do the same thing. Let's go ahead and unselect the head right there. I might actually cut that and paste it as a separate layer. There we go. Now I can color that code with the hands, which is great. And for the head, I think the head is looking okay. It's a little bit hard to tell because it's always a good idea just to go back and forth inside your Maya. Typically, I'm going to make this a little bit darker, just ever so slightly. All right. Okay, that's looking good to me. Let's go ahead and adjust the other layers. So we've got buttons. We've got the torso. Let's go use the magic wand and select those textures right there. So I have said it a few times. When you're working on something like this, guys, take it nice and slow, okay? Don't be afraid to take longer than usual, unless you're on a deadline, in which case that would not be good. But remember, this is very tweaky. There's a lot of things we have to do to make it look, to make a texture look readable and make it look good. So I want to just be mindful of that whenever you're working on projects like this. Now I'm just making a mental map of how this is going to turn out. I don't believe the shirt is going to get enough detail, so what I want to do is darken it ever so slightly, like so. Give it a little bit of hue, because remember the lights will hit it and there's going to be slight specularity, some bump maps and such. So you don't want it to be too bright, otherwise things will look a bit strange. But that's okay, we can still adjust this even at the later stages. We're at a point where we're quite safe to make corrections, you know, later in the process, but we'll see how we go. The belts, let's go ahead and fix the belt up. Belt is actually supposed to be incredibly dark, supposedly. So I'll keep it as a fairly darkish brown, and this is going to be a leather material right there. So it's looking good. Now the jacket, or the vest, maybe you could use a little bit of vibrancy because I want this to be, I want this character to sort of stick out. Don't want it to be too bright. Let's keep it fairly somewhere in the middle ground right there. Again, we can make adjustments later. All right, let's move on to the gums and teeth. At this point, that's just way too colorful. Looks a bit odd. So I want to mute it down, like so. Maybe even take some of that saturation down as well. Bring up the brightness. Okay. Teeth, I think they're looking fine. The eyes are pretty much on the spot there. We'll go ahead and create the irises. So I'm going to save this out. Let's go back into Maya, check it once again. And by the way, I do have a music playlist on my iPod, so I'm going to turn this on. Just give me 1 second. And as I mentioned before, music playlists are very useful because it helps you sort of stay focused on the task at hand. All right, let's go ahead and reload. You've noticed I haven't renamed any of these other nodes right now. I don't really need to because I can do that a little bit later. All right, so character's looking quite good. It's the head, probably I can make it a little bit lighter, but I think everything else is looking fine. So the tail, the hands, the feet are looking good. It's the head that's not selling it to me at the moment, so I'm going to fix that. Let's go back to Photoshop and adjust this. So for the head, I think I'm just going to color select and see if we can... Oh, that's far too vibrant, just too harsh. That's too low. So it can be a bit tricky trying to get a good middle ground for all of your textures. So the mustache, once again, I don't think it was really nice. So I'm going to color select and do that. Just make some adjustments here. Yep. Might make put it on the darker side because it's easier to add a little bit of highlights as we go. Great. Save this again. Let's go back to my reload. So this is how we do texturing traditionally anyway. We go back and forth between Photoshop and then the 3D app, and then you go back to Photoshop, you make those changes, paints and all that stuff. That's how the texture artists work, okay? Generally. These days they use sculpting tools like Mudbox or ZBrush or even Mari. All these little texturing tools, honestly, they do the same thing. It doesn't matter. The point isn't about the tool, the point is to get the result, okay? So if you prefer to use just Mudbox, then hey, you certainly can go ahead. All the principles are exactly the same. There's nothing different or weird about it. Just go ahead and do it. Now, I need to find the nose, which has gone missing because I don't know where I put it. I'm certain I put it somewhere. I must have completely forgotten to add that into my scene. Let me just double check. Ah, I see. Okay, so it was actually just this little thing down here. Very, very strange. All right, let's go ahead and just select the nose. So for the nose, I'm going to do this separately. So let's go nose. Oh, pardon me. Control Shift V to paste on the exact same spot. So go nose. And the nose is going to be a slightly pinkish kind of a color. So that's what we're going to aim for. Again, basing it completely on my thing right there. Yeah, let's reload this and see what we get. Where is my, there it is. Let's reload. There we go, that's our farmer character. So if I go to my preview right here, you can look at him and go, hey, that does kind of look like the character right now. And hey, we didn't really spend too much time on this. Let's take this further. Let's see what else we can do. Let's go ahead and start with the ears, and then I might start drawing a few brows. And I guess we'll take it from there and see how far we can take it. All right, so the brows, let me just go ahead and with the skin, I'm going to again create a new folder underneath the skin. Let's go L1. Now, this is level one detail. This is the detail on top of all of my diffuse colors right now. All right, so we start off with L1, and these are broad strokes. Again, just broad strokes, nothing special. Using my trusty little Wacom tablet right here, I'm going to go ahead and select the brow. And just putting it on top right there. And I'm just trying to keep in mind whether or not this is going to look good or not. So, all right, let's duplicate. Duplicate and mirror it to the other side. It's the easiest way to go about this. All right, that's our brow. For the eyes, we're going to have to add some eyeshadow. Now remember, these eyeshadows here help accentuate the eyeball itself. It's like ambient occlusion, but not quite. Generally, I don't want to. Generally, you would use ambient occlusion. I'm trying to find where my little feathered brush went. I have no idea. Where's my brush? I'm trying to find it. Generally, you would want to use baked ambient occlusion. I'm going to just use this as a placeholder, and I have no idea where that brush is. Incredible. Out of all my brush libraries, I don't even have the basics. So let's go ahead and tell you what I mean. I'm just trying to get that created, that brush right there. So the hardness, put it down to 0. Let's go pen pressure. What I'm doing is getting a feathered brush, really. So, whatever happened to my thing? Okay, very, very, very odd. All right, let's just add that airbrush. That's what I was trying to say. I wasn't sure what to call it. So airbrush, let's go airbrush 2. Great. So the airbrush all the way down the very bottom right here. Let's go ahead and select it and change the size. Okay, so the eyeshadow is simply there to help accentuate the eyeballs. But as I said, this is just the placeholder. Let's just go ahead, save that out, and make sure we have that in one spot. All right, I should probably have this open constantly from now on. There we go. Okay, so that's generally what you want. not as harsh as that, guys, but at least you kind of get the point. You'd again, like I said, you would use ambient occlusion to do that. That's all right, I'm not going to bother. I'm just going to use that as a placeholder so that we can at least see which direction we're trying to take this. I'm going to shrink it a little bit. Duplicate. Oh no, I've lost it. Very important that you work slowly. There's no need to rush. Let's go ahead, duplicate. Let's flip. So do let me know, guys, if you want, in these episodes of Let's Build, if you want me to cover something specific, or if I'm going too slowly in terms of episodes. Do you want me just to stick with the whole workflow from start to finish, which, by the way, will make for very long episodes, and I'll kind of release on a bi-weekly basis to speed things up. But if you want that, then certainly let me know. I'll definitely do that and check it out. All right, let me save this out. And I need to just go for a quick break. I'll come straight back and continue this job right here. Okay, so the eyes are looking really, really nice. That's what you want. Okay, that's probably good enough already as far as I can tell. All right, guys, I'm going to cut it right here. I'll be back in just a moment. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back, and I must apologize if you're looking at this at a slightly low resolution. It's because my screen capture has crashed twice since I took a break. So it's really, really frustrating. I've lost the footage, unfortunately. We're just going to keep going on. Basically, what I've been doing in the past, between the break and now, I've gone ahead, added some extra, gradients around my textures right here. I've done it on the ears. You can see I've created it, created the nose, added it on the feet, the tail. I think I did on the tail before, and also add some subtle little shades around the arms and such. So those are the gradients. That's generally how I work. That's the style that I'm going for. Again, I want to keep these characters slightly cartoonish. Don't want them to be too photorealistic. Okay, now what I've been also doing is adding some extra grunge on the torso textures, or the vest right in here. And the grunge is basically made up of simple textures, or the texture maps that you can get from cgtextures.com. So just head over to CG Textures, and you can get any of these textures for free for any of your commercial or private projects. And what I've done is I'm going ahead and just trying to find some textures. So I've been using the decal stains here, like so, and what I did was I just simply copied and pasted it in here, did some color correcting, and simply changed it from, right now we are at normal composite, so I'm going to change the composite to overlay. Okay, so that's essentially what I did, and the end result is something like that. Well, not exactly like that. Let me just save this out. So before it crashed, I was actually in the process of creating the even more higher level details, namely the cloth, but right now we're looking really nice. It's looking really good with the grunge right now. I should probably save this out. So just in these last 20 minutes, I'm going to keep texturing. Maybe it was a good thing that I crashed, that the screen capture crashed, so that you guys can see a little bit ahead of the textures or the process. So just save it out, reload. Remember, an 8K texture like this is massive, so it's going to take a while to update. So it's looking really, really nice. You can see the grunge textures are coming out, or reading really well, to my eyes anyway. You're just telling yourself, you're going, oh, okay, it's like he's been working in the sun for a long period of time. We're still going to add more grunge textures later, but for right now, this is enough just to get a starter for our project. So the next thing I want to do is go ahead and add some fabric detail, very, very subtle fabric detail. Remember, we're going to create the normal mask for this at a later stage. We just want to get the diffuse textures down. We'll be using a combination of Endo 2, which you see me use very often in Photoshop, Basically, it's a normal map generator. You can use any normal map generator if you want. It doesn't really matter as long as the result is good. But I choose Endo2 because the customization options are broader and much easier to use. Okay, it's easier to get a better result. The other thing you also want to use for broader stroke normal maps, for example, cloth folds or creases, you want to use something like Mudbox or ZBrush to create a very high poly sculpt, and use that high poly sculpt to create some seams and such. Okay, so that's how you those are the two ways you generate normal maps. We're going to use both, a combination of both of them, to get a really good result. But for now, I'm going to go ahead and grab a cloth or fabric, a fabric texture. Let's just select this and paste that inside. All right, and just looking down at this right now. So in relation to the texture map right here, or the resolution, this is actually too large. So I'm going to shrink this down significantly. Okay, because what I really want is something that is sort of to scale to my character. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and add some cloth folds here. Now remember, this is slightly curved. I'm not too worried about that. If I have to change it, I'm going to change it in Mudbox, so don't worry too much about that for now. Right now, all we really want to do is just get the broad strokes down. Okay, so that's what I'm doing. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and tile this out. Let's go ahead and start erasing some of those harsh edges. Okay, so that's looking good. Let's go ahead and paint this down here. I hope you guys can see these details. I have lowered the resolution of my screen capture so that it won't crash. So the image quality or the video quality is going to be slightly different. But hopefully you guys can get the gist of what we're trying to achieve here. Let's go ahead, duplicate again, like so. And there we go. Alright, I'm going to shrink it down. Just make it two size to my little texture or the UV map. All right, I'm going to delete the segment. Okay, and how we want to composite this? Well, there's a number. You can try a number of things. We're going to try overlay as generally a starting point, but if that doesn't work, I'm going to see what else we can do to make that texture kind of pop out. Remember, all I really want is just the black and white values, or the light and dark value, so to speak. So I'm pretty happy with hard light for now. Let's go ahead and try this out. It may or may not work. I might go to my multiply, perhaps. Zoom in a little bit and just see what we've got. So that's looking pretty good. I'm just checking these subtle crevices in the fabric texture itself. So it's a bit hard to see, so I hope you guys can at least read that somewhat. I'm kind of happy with that. Although I don't want this to be, you know, too colorized, I'm going to lower the saturation and maybe... Actually, I might change the composite mode. So let's go ahead and try something different. See what else we got. So overlay may work. Might work. I'll go ahead and give this a go. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. It's reasonable. Again, trying to maintain that texture I had before. It's not too bad. Well, we'll go ahead and duplicate it across. And flip this around. Unbelievable, I didn't duplicate. Let's try that again. Let's go slowly. There we go, that's better. Great. Alright, I'm happy with that as a starting point. I'm not too worried. Again, not worried about details right now or accuracy. Just want to get a general gist of the entire process. So let's turn this back to overlay. What I did was I just merged the layers right there. Okay, so let's give this a go. Now you can, I'm going to put this underneath a grunge. Maybe I get a different result. No, maybe not. Don't worry about it. Alright, let's go ahead. Reload. Now remember that fabric is not going to conform to that, so it's going to look a bit off or weird, as you can see. See, we've got some strange, very, very strange look to that. The back of the fabric is looking fine. Everything else is a bit strange. That's alright, we can fix that in, we'll fix that up using Mudbox. Again, Mudbox will be used to create a new texture for that. But this bottom one, we're not as worried because it's going to be fine. Generally, anyway. So we're nearing the end of this episode. And as always, guys, if you have any suggestions of what I can do that to make this more helpful for you guys, let me know in the comment section below. I will do my best to check that out. Okay, I've got the fabric. Once again, the fabric. I'm going to go overlay. I'm going to stick with overlay because I like how it contrasts with the rest of that thing. I'm losing my words already. Okay, I'm going to reduce the saturation because I don't want to lose that color. Not all of it, just leave a little bit of saturation so that it bleaches the color ever so slightly. It just helps with the end result. Now with the textures here, that's the grunge. I'm just trying to find the shadows wherever they went. I don't believe I think I've put the shadows in the wrong place somewhere. Luckily I've got this all sorted out in very, very useful little things. No, I think I've officially lost it. Oh, it's actually on. Never mind, it's fine. I'm going to create a new layer. I want to exaggerate some of that shading. So I'm going to go ahead and create a new layer. Just add a very, very subtle amount of shading to certain areas here. Just to help darken that ever so slightly. Okay, again, a cartoony look. We're just exaggerating some of these features. This is not photorealistic at all, so if you want photorealistic, it's going to take a lot of tweaking to get right. It's not to say stylized art is easier. It's just simply, it's just different. So it's up to you and up to how the art department wants to tackle their work. Okay, so there we go. That's the vest looking really nice right now. Okay, very readable. We're going to have to add some stitches later on, perhaps, and probably add some more little grungy features there. But other than that, very, very readable. So you can see the process of texturing. You start off very simply with color coding. Color coding your skin, the diffuse texture, making sure everything's looking right. By the way, this is my style of texturing. And then you move on to gradients. You know, fake ambient occlusion, so to speak, just to bring out some of those features to make it a little bit more readable. And then from there, you can start adding textures on top. And I'm going to do this exact same process up until all the way to the finish line, as best as I can using just Photoshop. And then once I'm happy with that, I'm going to go into Mudbox, and start some detailed texturing there, okay? So certain areas, like for example, this fabric right here, because of the way I tackled the UV maps, I'm going to have to manually use Mudbox to paint downward strokes to get those fabric, those grains going horizontal with that. So that's the reason why you want to use Mudbox for certain things. This is definitely one of those areas that you need to. Other things include, of course, we've got to do normal map sculpting, which is actually not as difficult as people may think, and it's not as time-consuming as you may make it out to be. But we still need to do that because just having a flat texture like this, I mean, if this is the style that you're going for, that's great, totally fine. But I want to push the realism a little bit more, okay? So I want to get this looking fairly realistic, but still maintain that cartoony look, okay? All right, guys. So I hope this has been very helpful. As always, if you have any suggestions, leave them in the comment section below. I may skip the rest of the texturing process in the next episode and just go straight to the sculpting part. Just to keep this really nice and streamlined, because I do find that it does drag on if I continue going on, on and on the same workflow. And it just doesn't make for a very interesting watch. All right, but do subscribe if you like this content. As always, I will see you guys next time. I completely messed that outro up. So, all right, I'll catch you guys later.